our Lord Jesus Christ said, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Even as ye are called, and one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, Lord Jesus Christ, the only and this nation to thy merciful care, that being guided by thy providence, we may dwell secure in thy peace. Grant to the President of the United States and to all in authority wisdom and strength to know and to do thy will. Fill them with the love, truth, and righteousness, and make them ever mindful of their calling to serve this people in thy fear. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end.
Amen.
O Lord God of hosts, stretch forth, we pray, thy almighty arm to strengthen and protect the armed forces of our country. Support them in the day of battle, and in the time of peace, keep them safe from all evil. Endue them with courage and loyalty, and grant them in all things they may serve without reproach. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father of all mercies,
we need thy unworthy service. Do give thee most humble and hearty thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men. We bless thee for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for thy inestimable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we beseech thee, give us that due sense of all thy mercies, that our hearts may be unfeignedly thankful, and that we show forth thy praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to thy service, and by walking before thee in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom be thee and the Holy Ghost, be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all evermore.
Amen.
Good morning. Just a few announcements. We do have our St. Michael's luncheon on for the 2nd. I see a lot of people have already signed up for that. That'll be after the service, so please continue to sign up for that fun time. I look forward to that. That'll be sort of our October, the end of September, October event for this cycle. But anybody interested in any events for October and November, any ideas at all, please bring them forward. I'm more than happy for us to use your talents and gifts for the glory of God. I also encourage us to continue this week in camp and prayer. We started the book of Job and still working our way through Matthew. Both of those are challenging works. And remember, any questions you have in those readings are more than applicable for our family Bible study on 9:30 on Sunday morning. Also, there's a new Trinitarian that is studying in the Catholic Church in the back. Feel free to avail yourself of that. And also, I am going to have to beg off the Irish class today. My father used to say that having a school-aged child is a bit like owning one's own rat during the bubonic plague. And I have come down with something, seeing 75 children 2 times a day. So I apologize for that. I'm under strict orders from my wife to go home, so I will be doing that. But we will continue that class next week. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our heart be always acceptable in thy sight, the Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
Amen.
For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. St. Luke 14:11. As we approach today's reading from the Gospel according to St. Luke, we may be asking ourselves one or two questions. Namely, what is Jesus doing there, and why do I care? This account, with its two-faced Pharisees and seemingly arcane discussion on Sabbath conduct, its advice on proper first-century seating selection etiquette, and personal humbleness, will certainly never be chosen as the text for one of those gimmicky sermons, ones that are overly dramatic ones from places that call themselves worship experiences. I know I would have trouble preaching about humility with my face on an enormous projector screen. Of course, there'd also be the issue of trying to find a screen big enough to fit my entire head on it. That's certainly a problem between me and every half store I ever walked into in America. Unfortunately, we do not do humility very well at all in our country. and our failure as Americans to embrace this key part of living life, sacrifice to God, ripples throughout our land. One need only look at this year's presidential candidates to see this principle in action. Humble being a word no one would use to describe the man or woman who will serve as the head of our secular state for at least the next 4 years. We are far cry from Anglican George Washington stepping down after 8 years. Where did that come from? It came from Christian humility. Whatever we do well in America, we are not a humble country, and we become less so every day. If we bristle at this characterization, it is probably because we are either grading ourselves in a curve by saying something like, well, we are certainly more humble than other people, or we may believe that we have reason to brag by saying something like, well, America is a blessed country, and my pride is simply because we are the people God particularly loves. The grave problem for the Christian who holds these views is that they are almost indistinguishable from the views held by the Pharisees regarding their nation. The Pharisees judge their own humility against that of their neighbors, rather than that set by the holy God they claim to serve. Think of the prayer of the Pharisee in Luke 18. God, I thank you that I'm not like other men. The Pharisees also believed that they would be delivered from the occupying Roman Empire, and that their nation would rule the world with military strength because of their national identity and their special status before the Lord. Missing, of course, that their continuous breaking of God's law condemned them in the eyes of the Mosaic Covenant established in Exodus chapter 24. This mistaken confidence in their national superiority drove the Pharisees into misleading their fellow Jews into a series of suicidal wars against the greatest military power the world had ever known. Wars that led to the destruction of the temple and the slaughter of tens of thousands. These similarities should make all of us a bit uncomfortable, particularly because this false pride in themselves rather than in God contributed to the Pharisees destroying their nation. And more important, vastly more important, this false pride blinded them to the kingdom of God being inaugurated in their very midst. As we examine another uncomfortable moment, this dinner party described by St. Luke, we see the very men who say that God will always bless and vindicate their nation, conspiring together to betray the God they saved and love. You'll also see that the humility Jesus is talking about is not the small things like bragging or being considerate in a conversation. Although these are important, we will see that self-pride is much, a much bigger idea that affects every single part of our lives. Some questions as we consider the text today. Who do we exalt in our lives? And how do we humble ourselves? These are not just questions regarding those social niceties through which we too often try to tame the subversive yet authoritative nature of Christ's commands. These are very much questions of life and death. Chapter 14 of St. Luke's Theological History of Jesus the Messiah reveals the incarnate Son of God eating with his enemies on the Sabbath. In the last verses of chapter 13, Jesus foreshadows the great injustice that will soon take place in Jerusalem, saying, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. St. Luke 13:34. Jesus, as prophet, priest, and king, knows that each step he takes is bringing him closer to the mocking crowds and the bloody wood of Good Friday. However, even as he considers all the slain prophets who have gone before him, including his beheaded cousin John the Baptist, Jesus cries out in sadness to the very people who will kill him. We see here not only a beautiful reminder of the love of God for humanity. But we also see why Jesus would agree to eat dinner with people who were seeking evidence by which he could be prosecuted for blasphemy. Why were they seeking this evidence? Because the teaching and miracles of Jesus were dangerous in the eyes of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the two leading religious parties in Judea. These parties saw these works as a very real threat to their power. As traditional and Orthodox Christians, we should learn a very valuable lesson from these groups, who thought they were being the defenders of conservatism. If one is trying to conserve the pronouncements of the living God, who radically opposes the reign of sin and death that has existed in every culture the world has ever known, then yes, Christianity is very, very conservative. However, if one means by conservative that Christianity is attempting to maintain perpetually the status quo of a particular age, made perfect in our minds by the distance of time or a misunderstanding of the gospel, then we are definitely not conservative. Every age has its evil. Every age needs to be redeemed. What's even more fascinating here is that Jesus, surrounded by the evil of his age, will use the pride and arrogance of these powerful Pharisees against him. As the 5th century church father Cyril of Alexandria put it, Jesus knew that even against their will, he would make them eyewitnesses of his power and superhuman glory. In a sad and pathetic attempt to trap Jesus into breaking the prohibition against working on the Sabbath, Jesus' possible hosts have seated him right next to a man suffering from dropsy or an overaccumulation of fluid in the body. Interestingly, St. Luke, a physician himself, uses the ancient Greek medical term for the disease. I always find that it's fascinating that the individual personalities of gospel writers kind of poke through the narrative. Now, the rabbis or religious leaders who had interpreted the law for centuries had generally determined that one could administer medical care to someone on the Sabbath in a life or death situation. However, this man with dropsy was not technically in a life or death situation. He fell into a gray area. These legalistic and uncharitable men are so blinded by their pride and arrogance that they don't simply ask Jesus to heal the suffering man. They've seen him do it. And instead, attempt to use this man, this suffering man, as a pawn in this most dangerous game. When faced with the miraculous signs done by Jesus, which should have alerted them to the fact that the prophesied savior of their people was sitting right before them, these prideful and self-confident men retreated into their comfort zone. They retreated to the law, to the words over which they believed they had power through their interpretation and additions. But the tragic irony of the scene is that they were sitting before the lawgiver himself, the one who truly is the Lord of the law, the King of the Sabbath. Just as the pattern of resting on the seventh day was established by the creative activity of the Trinity, recorded in the book of Genesis, so here, that same God, represented by the second person of that same blessed Trinity, can choose to work on the Sabbath as a signaling action of the invasion of God in creation. Creation is beginning anew. The Creator God is repairing what we have destroyed. The God who created the Sabbath turns this question on the pride of Pharisees. Is it lawful to heal the Sabbath? One can only imagine the primate pause that followed those words as the Pharisees found themselves caught in their own trap. In truth, they really did not have a good and definitive answer to this question. And that is why they are trying to spring it on Jesus. Jesus refuses to play this silly game. And in the midst of their impotent silence, he heals the man and sends him home. If that wasn't condemnation enough, after revealing his power before them, Jesus then proceeds to show that they are enormous hypocrites who don't even follow their own uncharitable interpretation of the law. He tells them, "Which of you, having a son or an ox that has fallen into a well on the Sabbath day, will not immediately pull him out?" St. Luke 14:5. Again, they can only respond in the sincere silence of a convicted conscience. Now, if we see that pride is at the heart of the Pharisees' self-righteous theology, we begin to understand the importance of the parable that follows the healing. To start, whenever we hear Jesus describe a feast, we should have a few images in our mind. First, we should notice how important feasts are in the ministry of Jesus. For example, why of all the miracles that Jesus could have enacted, does he choose, at least on two occasions, to feed thousands of people? The feast miracles are a physical enactment of the parables which so often speak of feasts, including the next chapter of Luke, wherein we are confronted by the parable of the prodigal son. Second, we should notice the trajectory of all these feasts within the narrative. These physical and parabolic feasts are unstoppably driving us toward the great sacramental feast of the Last Supper, through which the people of God are united with Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. Lastly, with these feasts in our mind, we should be able to tell that here in the 14th chapter of Luke, we are not dealing with a 2,000-year-old proverb on etiquette. No, we are dealing with a discussion of the great eschatological feast, the feast in which the Holy Eucharist, which we will partake of today, is a blessed foretaste, the feast the people of God will enjoy forever in the fully consummated kingdom of God, the new heaven and the new earth. It is for this reason that the humility of the wedding guest is so important. The wedding feast that Jesus is talking about is the beginning of the existence for which we were created. We were not created to work and pay taxes and buy things and die. That doesn't make all those things equal, but that is not why we were put on this earth. And it is certainly not why all the Christians in this room have been reborn. As St. Paul writes, "God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not of your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, which God prepared before him, that we should walk in." Ephesians 2:4-10. All of the justified sinners in this room were dead in sin, and we still feel that pull toward the comforting familiarity of the tomb. But we must resist, for we are destined for so much more. Whenever we look up from our daily labors and see a planet in turmoil, a dying world that even the lost know is somehow wrong, we as a church need to be there with real solutions to the problems that they face. I say they as if we don't need the same reassurances, for it is so easy to fall into the groupthink of our communities and become just like all those who live without hope. For we are not better than our neighbors. We simply serve a king who is greater than us all. Every minute that we no longer serve him is a minute in which we betray everything that is good about us. An unrepentant sinner who goes to church is not a pagan with a get-out-of-jail-free card. He is just a lost soul who we should be helping with our prayers and our love and our witness. We honor that Christ, but we have nothing. Again, as Paul says, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared before him, that we should walk in them. We are either recreated in Christ, revealed by our work for his kingdom, or we are still the enemies of God. We are still like these Pharisees, consumed by our pride and self-righteousness, until we will even kill or let others kill people to perpetuate the illusion of our counterfeit righteousness. But why humility? Why service? Why sacrifice? Why do we need to do any of these things? The answer, as St. Paul has made abundantly clear, is not to earn our salvation. As if anything I could do could possibly compare to what Christ has done for me through the cross and the empty tomb. No, here is just more pride. Here is just more self-righteousness, dressed in piety rather than avarice. As Christians, we are called this life of loving and humble service because the only way to show who we are exalted, literally who we are lifting up, is to live a life of humiliation for the King who humbled himself for us when he allowed his rebellious creatures to lift him high across the time for the sins of the whole world. The only way to show that we truly believe that the momentary pleasures we could gain by hoarding money or abusing our neighbors or misusing our bodies are nothing compared to the new earth that awaits us is to give and serve and love the kingdom that we pray every day will come. For when Christians pray the Lord's Prayer, we are not just mouthing a solemn wish. No, we are praying as our mighty King has commanded us to pray. We are praying to the same King who will return in glory to enact righteous vengeance against all those who have exalted themselves. We are praying that victorious King, whose will be the force that finally brings the peace and justice for which the world aches. Let us all then, while we have been blessed with another day, look to our own lives and ask, who am I exalting with my life? If the answer is any name other than Jesus, pray for forgiveness or prepare for wrath. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in the heaven and in the earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom of the Lord, and thou art exalted as head above all.
the name of Jesus.
receive your sacrifice at thy hands, to the praise and glory of his name, both to our benefit and that of all his holy church.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church.
Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations, and to receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word, and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also so to direct and dispose the hearts of all Christian rulers, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in the holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we must humbly beseech you of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Especially Gloria, Frank, Francis, Bay, Kim, Colby, Joe, Joseph, and Judy, Bertie, the Kairos outside, Mary Sue, Jennifer, Jerry, Pat, Britta, Dwight, Tiffany, John, Matthew, Cole, Sherry, Don, Terry, Dan, Jason, Jim, Charles, Jen, Kayla, and all who are injured in last night's finals. We also bless thy holy name for all thy servants, depart this life in thy faith and fear. Beseech thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
Ye who do truly and earnestly repent of your sins, and are willing to share with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God devoutly kneeling.
Almighty God,
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and our heart is sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with heart of repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what comfortable words our Savior Christ hath unto all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Here also the same Paul said, this is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Here also what St. John said, if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation.
our sins.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is very meet and abounding duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, ever all praising thee and saying,
who made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and an institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. From the night which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many, for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me." We, thy humble servants, do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness, vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed. and we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Most humbly beseeching thee to grant that, by the merits and death of thy Son Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all of the benefits of this passion. And here, we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee. Humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us, and we in him. And although we are unworthy for our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
And now, as the Savior Christ taught us, we are bold to say,
thank you.
vouchsafed to feed us, who have duly received these holy mysteries, with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and has assured us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very numbers incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, for the merits of his most precious death and passion. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
O Lord Jesus Christ, who sets up thine apostles, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Regard not our sins for the faith of thy church, and grant unto it that peace and unity which is according to thy will, who livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end.
Amen.
Peace of God, that's all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
hushed, and the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then in thy mercy, grant us a safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may the soul, the faith, the body, the mercy of God rest in peace.
Amen.
As the